Welcome to Zion's Church this beautiful morning. My name is Danielle. I've been filling in, this is my third time now, filling in for Pastor Carl. So I just want to say thank you so much for having me back. In the past two services, my dad was able to come along, but today I have my husband Josh with me and our two children, Owen and Raylan. Does anybody have any announcements this morning before we begin? All right, then let us begin worship. Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. With you. Let us pray. Sovereign God, you turn your greatness into goodness for all the peoples on earth. Shape us into willing servants of your kingdom and make us desire always and only your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first lesson is from the 53rd chapter of Isaiah, beginning with the 4th verse. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted for him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent. So he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he has poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Here ends the reading.
We will now read responsive thy whole verse to Psalm 91. Psalm 91 is found in the celebrant. Because you have made the Lord your refuge and the Most High your habitation,
no evil will befall you, nor shall affliction come near your
dwelling. For God will give the angels charge over you to guard you in all your ways.
Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone.
You will tread upon the lion cub and viper. You will trample down the lion and the serpent.
I will deliver those who cling to me, and I will uphold them because they know my name.
They will call me and I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them.
With long life will I satisfy them and show them my salvation.
The second reading is from the fifth chapter of Hebrews, beginning with the first verse. Every high priest chosen from among mortals is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because of this, he must offer sacrifice for his own sins as well as for those of the people. And one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he was suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. And here ends the reading.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." The Gospel of the Lord. Today's message should encourage us to be servants of Christ. After all, isn't this the idea that we embody as Christians? There are many verses in the Bible where God commands us to serve him. One example is 2 Chronicles 19. "You must serve faithfully and wholeheartedly in the fear of the Lord." To better understand the meaning of serve, we can take a look at the Hebrew word abad. The verb translation means to serve, attend, minister, work, worship, present, or bring. The noun translation means opening door or entrance. Is Jesus calling you to serve? For me, I have always felt him calling me to do something more, something greater. This part of this message may come out sounding more like a testimony than a sermon, but I believe that God places you right where you are meant to be, and I believe that he wanted me to deliver this message, not just to change my life, but to inspire yours as well. Some of you may recall my first time filling in for Pastor Carl back in June. That message was from Mark chapter 5. Illustrating the woman who grabbed Jesus' cloak because she desperately needed healing, and because of her faith, she was healed. Last week, the message was from Mark chapter 10, where Jesus explains to us that we should let down whatever treasures or baggage we may be carrying, just like the illustration of the camel fitting through the eye of a needle. To let these things go so that we may focus on our treasures in heaven rather than the distractions of our belongings in this world. And here we are today, reading the passage of Jesus telling his disciples that just like him, we should focus on serving, giving our lives to serve for him and through him, to be servants to others, just as he came to serve us and give up his life to save us from our sins. I believe that God's divine plan was to first show me that through times of brokenness, he has healed me. Secondly, that I should let down whatever is holding me back from fitting through the eye of the needle, and to move forward to fulfill his design plan for me to serve him by becoming a minister. God continues to remind me to follow his bigger plan for my life. Just like on Friday evening while working at my second job, my coworker and I were blessed to have a very meaningful conversation. And I know that he was speaking through her to encourage me to take these next steps to fulfill what God has planned to do in my life. This road ahead is very daunting to me, as it is something new and would be changes to mine and my family's life. I am a creature of habit, and I tend to become very comfortable in my routines, and I have a hard time making a change unless God makes a change for me. As much as I desire to do the work of God wholeheartedly, it is difficult to take the next step. But I know that God will continue to call on me to serve him, and he will prepare me and supply me with all that I need to do just that. Just yesterday, I was on my way to my parents' home to begin writing my sermon. I was listening to contemporary Christian music in my car, as most of the time I do. And like many times before, I believe God plays the right songs at the right time. All three songs were so applicable to my life at this current time that there was no doubt that he was using these songs to speak to me. One of the chorus's words saying, "We're on our way to breaking through because we're made for something new. We're on our way to chase our dreams because we were made for greater things." The other song's words played, "For the dreams that died, for the tears that I've cried, for the weakness that bears witness to the grace that you supply. There's a river that delivers me to freedom, and the current of his mercy brings restoration. If my wounds could tell one story, let it be a testimony that you don't leave me where I've been. If this is healing, let it begin." I knew, after hearing these songs, that God is working in me to heal me and bring me to something new. Have you ever, or do you now, hear the calling of Christ to serve him? Has he placed something on your heart that would honor and serve him? Sometimes I believe that we, including myself, can get caught up in our daily lives, so focused on what we need to do to get through our days, that we miss the opportunity to serve him by serving one another. Sometimes we may get lost and find ourselves with distraction, such as social media, binge watching a TV series, or maybe a bad shopping habit. These are forms that entertain us with distraction out of boredom or trying to distract us from a more deeper need. There are some who find themselves so far from God that they fill the void with even worse habits, such as drugs or alcohol. These habits sneak into people's lives, just like the devil as the sneaky snake in the Garden of Eden. Disguise themselves rather as a comfort from pain or to fill a void from something that has been missing in their lives. This could come from searching for acceptance, love, or feeling like you're not enough, or maybe even from grieving a loss. God wants us to find ways to serve him, rather than filling our lives with distractions. If we begin to place him first in our lives and continue to fulfill our discipleship, then our lives will have more meaning. Our cup will be filled and overflow with goodness from him, rather than feeling like our cups are half empty. These other things will only fill the void momentarily and let you feeling empty in the end. God, on the other hand, if you give your time to him to serve him and do his work and spend time in his word, then you will find peace and joy and comfort. He wants to see you succeed and feel joy and share his love with people around you. And by doing so, you in turn will be blessed. Even on the days that are hard and difficult, if we choose to serve him and praise him, even in the hard times, he will provide us with comfort and peace and healing. So I ask you, what does it look like living a life of serving Christ? If you are unsure, pray about it, and he will reveal to you what he wants you to do. We probably already have implemented some of the easier traits that just come naturally as Christians. By being honest, having integrity, respect, and love for one another. Being here today, attending Sunday service, and spending time with God. Other examples of serving Christ may look like donating food to the food bank, or to someone in need, or maybe sending donations to those who were affected by Hurricane Helene and Milton. Many have traveled to serve God to provide relief and supplies to those in need who were affected by these weather-related tragedies. We can serve God by spending time in his word, by sharing his word, praying to him for others, and by sharing our faith in his love with others. The more time we spend serving our God, the better quality of life we will live. All of these distractions and addictions and bad habits are like cobwebs in our lives. They are sticky and messy and distract us from enjoying what is in front of us and what lies ahead of us. God wants us to take in the beauty around us and the blessings that he has provided us with, and to share those blessings to those around us. Use our talents to serve him. Help bring people to him. Give people hope. Share the salvation of Christ. Let them know that because of the cross, there is grace and mercy new every day. They too can turn their lives toward Christ, and by serving him, their cup can overflow with goodness and joy and peace too. I know that in theory, this paints an almost perfect picture. And yes, there is definitely a life filled with more joy with Christ. But we must also follow through with, God does not promise a life without pain or suffering. For we are still on earth, not yet in heaven. But to know that it is much easier to go through struggles with him than to go through it alone. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 11, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." He will give you peace and comfort like nothing else in this world could ever give you. I believe that by having our hearts in the right position, by keeping our hearts turned toward God and living a life to serve him, is exactly the message that Jesus wants us to know. It may seem difficult to take time to spend time with him and to serve him throughout your day. But if little by little you make some of these part of your daily life, soon it will become like second nature. Pray to him. Ask God to help you in being a better servant of Christ. Ask him to show you the way he wants you to serve. Each of us are here on this earth to share together all the gifts and the abilities he has provided us with. We are all made special in his image. No one of us is made completely the same, so that we can all bring many things to the table. God wants us all to come to the table to serve our gifts and our abilities from our plates, to pass them around at his table so that we can bless others with what God has blessed each of us with. We are here to serve him by following him, loving him, and sharing his love. Joshua chapter 22 says, "But be very careful to keep the commandment and the law that Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you. To love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, to keep his commands, to hold fast to him, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul." Lastly, Acts 20 reads, "In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words the Lord Jesus himself said, It is more blessed to give than to receive. Amen. Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. challenged by God's word in Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and the whole creation. Holy One, we give thanks for all servant leaders of the church. Bless bishops, pastors, and deacons with humble wisdom and ground them in your love. God of grace, Creative One, we give thanks for the delicate balance of the natural world. Kindle in us a spirit of caring strength and the preservation of habitats, food availability, and centers of refuge that all wildlife may thrive. God of grace, Empowering One, fill the leaders of governments with a spirit of service that prioritizes those on the margins due to job loss, underemployment, unsafe working conditions, and immigration status. May economic equity be achieved for all people. God of grace. Restoring One, send your angels to watch over, rescue, and protect those who are injured or ill. Nurse those who suffer hardship, disease, injury, or difficulty with your comfort and peace. God of grace. Abiding One, you call pastors to shepherd the congregation toward faithful living as servants and followers of Jesus. Inspire all ordained ministers and seminaries to the ministry that challenges, engages, and comforts those in their care. God of grace. Saving One, we give thanks for the disciples, James and John, and all saints who have faithfully served you. We rejoice in a promised place at the feast of victory that we receive by your grace alone. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the saving grace you freely give, both now and forever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us pray the prayer that our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.